Hey guys, welcome back to Young Americans Abroad, your best place for weekly content on young American soccer players playing overseas. My name is Austin Van Churen.
And my name is Patrick Ferry.
And welcome to our show.
So we're back, guys, and this week's episode, we're going to do our usual recap of how our young American players fared overseas, but we also have a special addition to this week's episode.
That's right. We want to talk about the U.S. men's national team roster that just came out this past Sunday to face Paraguay, so don't miss it. And then finally, we'll finish with our regular segment, Quick Kicks. So the first player we want to talk about this week is none other than Christian Pulisic. So Christian Pulisic was actually out for Dortmund's Europa League clash midweek against Red Bull Salzburg, and they actually lost that game 0-0.
That's disappointing, Austin.
It is very disappointing, especially because that means they're out of the Europa League now since they lost on aggregate. And that was pretty much Dortmund's last chance at winning a trophy, because we all know that Bayern have the Bundesliga wrapped up.
Yeah, it's a tough season for Dortmund and Pulisic.
Yeah, they're still, you know, I think they're third right now in the Bundesliga table after this week. Which isn't bad, you know, if you're talking about any other league pretty much in the world.
Sure. It just doesn't seem like, maybe it's just, I haven't watched enough games, but it just seems like it's not that usual Dortmund team that we've seen. Just a lot of, maybe just turmoil, maybe.
Well, yeah, especially to start the season with Peter Bosch, you know, exiting the club. That was definitely a tumultuous time for Dortmund, but things got a little brighter, you know, over the weekend. Dortmund actually won 1-0 against Hanover. And Christian Pulisic in this game actually played 70 minutes. Looked fairly active in the game. I think it was another good performance from him. Kind of shows that he's starting to get on the right track this year. Really starting to get that form back from what he had, you know, playing with the U.S. and even last year. And, you know, kind of to start the season this year.
And he had a little nutmeg, Austin, right? Is that correct?
Yeah, he had a nice nutmeg in the game. That was kind of his major highlight of this game down the right wing. It was pretty cool. If you want, look it up on Twitter. It's all over the place. Another promising game from Christian Pulisic. So now we want to talk about Matt Miazga, who actually got some honors this
week
in the Eredivisie. So, Pat, do you want to take over and talk about him?
Yeah, sure. I believe it's Who Scored, right?
Yeah, Who Scored Team of the Week,
Of the Week. So he was there along with his, another central midfield in Vitesse, Mason Mount, another loanee there.
Midfielder.
Yeah, another midfielder. But anyway, we don't know how accurate Who Scored is. I've heard some mixed reviews, but hey, any accolade is pretty good.
Positive
stuff. But this is 0-0 draw he played in against Hercules.
Okay.
I believe it is. Mm-hmm. Correct me if I'm wrong. But it's just great to see him bounce back from giving up 4 or 5 goals.
Five goals against Utrecht.
So that's not good. Great to see that clean sheet right before getting called into this U.S. Men's National Team against Paraguay, which we'll be covering later. But it's exciting stuff, Austin.
Yeah, that's exciting.
Like, and now shifting gears down to the second division there.
That's
right.
We're
going to talk about another striker that everyone's really excited about.
Yeah, who actually just got called up to the men's national team as well for his first call-up.
Congratulations.
Yeah, and that would be Andrija Novakovich. So Andrija actually scored again in Telstar's win this past weekend. We didn't really get to see his goal in the game. Mm-hmm. I know I didn't get to see it, but, you know, another goal for Andrija that brings his total to 18 now in the season. Wow. So
he's in great form coming into this opportunity.
Yeah, he's really lit up the Eredivisie, you know, this year. And, you know, like I said, I think one or two episodes ago, I wasn't sure if maybe now is the best time for him to get called up. But since he's been scoring pretty much the past, like, 5 or 6 games, it seems like he's scored every
incredible
game.
Incredible stat line, yeah.
Why not, I guess, call him up, see what is, you know, what he's like. There's not too many other strikers at the moment who are playing as well as him in the pool, so.
And this would be great, you know. like Austin was saying, just especially in the pool, and then also from Reading's side there, to see him get this call up into the camp, and also just how he's been doing this, you know, how well he's been doing this season is really, really great to see, and we expect some big things.
We were talking off camera a little bit. So what this call-up, we think, does for his position at Reading is it just shows Reading that since he's getting called into the men's national team for the USA, it's just another accolade on his resume next year, or I guess at the end of the season when he goes back to Reading, to show that he deserves minutes with Reading. So I think, you know, I said before in that last episode that maybe this March friendly isn't good for him, but looking at it again, it might be good for him to build his resume, and maybe this friendly will actually earn him game time with Reading coming up in the next season. So really exciting that he scored yet again, and really exciting that he got called up this weekend. So now we want to talk about another player who got called up this weekend, and that would be Anthony Robinson.
Another congratulations, Anthony.
Mm-hmm, that's right. But,
he got, like Austin said, a nice call up there, and he finally he got some game time in a 1-0 win against Aston Villa, entered in the 81st minute, I believe.
Yeah, because he's been out. He hasn't played the last few games, right?
Also, so they've been kind of changing up formations, and usually they have that, I think it's like a 3-5-2 or a 5-3-2, something along those lines, where he would be either kind of out in the, you know, kind of the left flank there, and either the left back or, you know, up attacking more in that five.
Yeah, like a left wing back.
Exactly, wing back, exactly. But, yeah, it's good to see him finally kind of getting back into that team. I know it seems like Bolton's been trying to test some things out as they're kind of shifting down towards that relegation zone, a little safe from it now. But it's exciting, though, like Austin said, that call-up, and it's a great opportunity for him, especially on loan, you know, from a club like Everton, again, puts him in a great spot, I think.
Yeah, no, for sure. I'm really excited to see him play, you know. I know we'll talk about him probably a little while,
more.
But I'm really excited that he got called up. So finally, the last player we want to talk about in this segment is Rubio Rubin, who actually got an assist in Club Tijuana's CONCACAF Champions League game against New York Red Bulls, which they actually ended up losing pretty handedly. But he got the assist on the first goal, a nice little weak cross across the box. Yeah, it was on the ground. But it was a nice pass, a good assist for Rubio Rubin, and that's his first assist at Club Tijuana. Yeah. So
nice to see him make an impact, Austin.
Yeah.
Just to hopefully kind of get more integrated in the team. And I guess from kind of, I guess, your perspective or things that you've seen, do you think Rubin's trying to find his footing a little bit? I know it's early, but...
Yeah, a little bit. I think, I mean, we've only seen maybe 2 or 3 games of him so far.
Yeah, Champions League, CONCACAF Champions League.
Games. Yeah, and he's kind of been moved around. Obviously, his main position is striker, and he's kind of been deployed on either wing for Club Tijuana so far. So I think he's starting to get his footing at the club. I think if he played in that striker position a little bit more, he might look more fluid. But when he's been on the field, he's been, you know, kind of dangerous. He's done a good job tracking back and just hustling, you know, putting in the hard work that a player should on the field. So I think if he continues to do that, you know, continues to impress in training, from what we've heard, it sounds like he's impressed in training. So I think, he'll keep getting minutes, and then that's good for us.
Oh,
that's good for the men's national team, because hopefully he'll be a player that we call on in the future and will make an impact.
Definitely.
And now that's it for this section of our episode, but now we want to shift over to our coverage on the U.S. men's national team roster against Paraguay. All right, so now we want to talk about the U.S. men's national team roster that was just released for their game against Paraguay. So how we'll do this is we'll go position group by position group and just touch on a few players here and there that we want to talk about. So the first position group, obviously, is goalkeepers. So we have a group of three here, and the first one's Bill Hamid, the second is Zach Steffen, and then finally Alex Bono.
And Austin, I know for Zach Steffen, you've been pretty high, and myself included, just really excited about him
and what
he can bring to the U.S. men's national team. Mm-hmm. So you want to, you know, tell us a little bit further, like what you think you like about him, or how he was. I know he did pretty well in the Columbus Crew playoffs last year, but...
Yeah, he did really good in the playoffs, especially against Atlanta United.
He's
an animal. but Zach Steffen's definitely probably our best goalkeeping prospect at the moment after Ethan Horvath's fall from grace over in Belgium.
Don't remind me. That was... I was telling you. I was like, oh, Ethan Horvath's the best. He's great.
Yeah, you were high on him.
I was so high on him.
I mean, that's fair. He looked like he was good, but... But yeah, so talking about Zach Steffen then. Zach Steffen looked great last year in the MLS. Obviously had a big playoffs, played really well in those playoffs. And then it started the season off strong this year, it looks like. So hopefully he'll be the number one goalkeeper in this game against Paraguay. However, I have a feeling that Bill Hamid will probably be the starter. But hopefully...
So just off of the, just being a veteran, you think, Austin? Or?
Yeah, I think Dave Sarakin will go with that veteran presence probably to lead the guys onto the field. Although, you know, he has selected this really, really young group of guys. So maybe he'll just go all youth and throw in some exciting, you know, young players that we haven't seen a lot of recently. And maybe that will be Zach Steffen. But I think either way, Zach Steffen and Bill Hamid will probably split halves, whether one starts and the other comes in later.
So we'll definitely, hopefully we'll see at least half for a Zach Steffen.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty safe bet, unless he gets injured or something else happens and he doesn't look good in camp, which I can't foresee. But yeah, so now do you want to talk maybe to us, Pat, about the defensive players that were called into this camp?
Sure, yeah. So the defensive players, especially, there's a few newcomers to this unit, which is great to see because as we've seen previously in the past, some of the gaps in, you know, especially with the outside backs not having a great established left back and some holes in the center have been part of our downfall.
Right.
But to go kind of through the center backs there, we have Matt Miazga, who's been playing very well at Vitesse, which we've touched on multiple times, along with Eric Palmer Brown. So that's great for him to finally, he's been rising through the youth national team ranks and to finally, get on there. This is a great opportunity for him to, prove his worth, even just training with the guys and being part of this group.
Right.
As he's just, as he's acclimating to a new environment with KV Kortrijk there.
Right.
So it's definitely an exciting call-up with him. And then also another player we've been high on is CCV, Austin.
Yeah, Cameron Carter-Vickers.
Yeah, Cameron Carter-Vickers picked up some good accolades there for Ipswich Town and has really come and hit the second loan there strong for the second half of this championship season. So excited to see from the center back perspective there.
Yeah.
And then also, we have a few outside backs, Austin, that you want to, name a few of them there?
Yeah, sure. So you have the two new guys, the two new call-ups, and that would be Shaq Moore and Anthony Robinson. And then also have kind of the more veteran presence of the fullbacks, the outside backs, and that would be DeAndre Yedlin, Jorge Villafania, and then finally Eric Lehigh. So, have a good blend here of experience and then also youth. I think DeAndre Yedlin obviously is a key figure in this camp.
Definitely,
I think he kind of needs to be a leader with this defensive group since he's, I guess he's not the most senior player in this group, but he's the player that's probably has the most caps.
Definitely.
I think definitely has the most caps.
And just as you were saying, I was thinking like how crazy that is. That remember DeAndre Yedlin at the last World Cup? Don't want to bring up World Cups, but.
Yeah,
just to imagine, like
for this point, it's a good thing.
For this point, it's crazy. Like imagine him; he was like that young guy in that group. So it's just crazy to kind of see. You know, he's had a pretty good season with Newcastle.
Like it's been good.
Up and downs, but it's just great to see him kind of really throughout this whole time of his career being a pretty key figure.
Yeah.
For the U.S.
Yeah,
but also we've been talking about Shaq Moore a bit.
Yeah,
and my opinions are congratulations. Great for him to get the call up,
right.
But not 100% sure it was deserving. But,
right.
Yeah.
You could argue. Because he hasn't really played since that game against Barcelona where they lost 4-0 in, I think it was early January.
Yeah.
So it was kind of surprising on our end to see Shaq Moore in this camp. But like we said, we're excited for a young player to
get called
in. And we now will hopefully get to see him. He might not play in this game. We were talking about that earlier. There's only 17 players that can play in this game if every substitution is made. So that means six players. Six players will miss out on this game. And we were talking that might be Shaq Moore just because he hasn't really played with the first team in a while, although he is playing with their B team there at Levante.
Yeah, and that's the key. If he can just break into that first team, I'll be more reassured of him. And he's still young. He has some time to develop, but especially the path that he's taken, kind of going over to a lower level Spanish team, working his way up the tiers and starting from there is exciting to see. And there was an article that came out a little while ago that we were going, I think we talked about, just about his kind of his rise and just him waiting patiently for that U.S. call up and conveniently and happened right now. So again, congratulations, and I hope he proves it.
Yeah, and it shows what some hard work and dedication to your craft can do.
So. And also, I know there's some exciting midfielders here that you want to discuss.
For sure. So you have the two most exciting midfielders, and that would be Tyler Adams and Weston McKennie. Then you also have Timothy Weah making his first call up for this national team. You also have some other players who've been there before, like Will Trapp, Kenny Saif, who's back for his second time. You also have Darlington Nagbe, Christian Roldan, Marky Delgado, and then finally the late addition to the team is Kakuta Mane. So a nice little group there. Not too many outside, winger type. Outside midfield players. It seems like you have a lot more of those eights and sixes, the central midfielders on this roster. So it'll be interesting to see what kind of lineup Dave Sarakin throws out onto the field and how he uses some of these players.
Yeah, definitely.
A player like Darlington Nagbe could either play centrally or he could play outside. So
It's interesting. It seems like that midfielder, maybe this group and just as a whole, the U.S. is trying to find that identity and trying out some of those sixes and eights and kind of seeing who gels well with other players, and it'll be exciting to see, Austin. And I know we've been talking a lot on this show about most of these people, but
that's right. A lot of these players in this camp, it seems like we've really touched on and have been talking about for the past few weeks who have been called into this camp, which is exciting for us because we get to see firsthand some of these players that we haven't really gotten a chance to see a lot of game time of.
Definitely. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, sorry to cut you off.
It's all good.
Talk about a point.
Yeah, just a little point here with Kenny Saif, which going on loan to Anderlecht seems like a great move for him. And unfortunately, when he was injured during that Ghana game, which we were talking about earlier.
Yeah, this past summer.
The Gold Cup. So, it'll be great to see kind of how he is integrated into this team. And just really want to see him, not just for that brief cameo, but really, more minutes than what he got. But just to see how he, moves the ball around. Because he's a player that's not going to beat you one-on-one. Not necessarily, not with speed. But he's very crafty, good with the ball, intelligent passes. Whips in some great balls as we've watched at Anderlecht. So
yeah, we have.
It'll be exciting to see. And I know there's a few other midfielders like McKennie that you've been high on as well with this lovely jersey.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's the McKennie jersey right here. So I'm excited to see Tyler Adams and Wes McKennie coexist on the field again. It'll be nice to see that again.
Yeah, because they played this previous, right?
Yeah, against Portugal in November, and they looked good together. Wes McKennie scored his first U.S. men's national team goal, so maybe we'll see another goal from him. First goal for Tyler Adams, that would be nice.
That would be.
Yeah, but another player that is really exciting to see on this roster for multiple reasons is Tim Weah. So I think it's good. It's obviously been discussed a lot on Twitter whether or not Tim Weah truly deserves this call-up. But I believe it's good for Tim Weah to be on this roster just because this shows him that we're fully committed to him as a player for us going forward. Obviously, he has a few decisions that you can make. You could either play for the French national team, Liberia, also, I believe, Jamaica through his mother's citizenship or ancestry. So he has some decisions to make in the future. Obviously, this game does not cap-tie him and tie him to the U.S. for good, but it does show him that we're prioritizing him, we're thinking about him as a player for the future. So that's why when people were a little upset with him getting called up only after making two appearances for PSG, I feel like we should just go on board with this Tim Weah call-up just because I think it could pay off for us in the long term. Especially you could see with Jonathan Gonzalez's switch to Mexico,
exactly
how if we don't call up maybe some of these players, it just shows to them that maybe we're not interested in them or conveys that message, even if that's not the message we're trying to convey. So I think with with this time around, talking about another dual national or tri-national, quad-national, national.
Something like that.
Yeah, I think this is a better approach and a different approach. So hopefully we'll see a different result with Tim Weah.
Definitely. Mm-hmm. And finally, we want to touch on some of these forwards.
That's right.
The few that they brought in. So we have Andrija Novakovich that we've been talking about a lot.
Yeah.
We also have Bobby Wood and Rubio Rubin. So Austin, what do you take from these three selections right
now? Yeah, an interesting mix of three strikers. A player who's just starting to break onto the scene over in Europe is Andrija Novakovich, a player who's had a horrible season in the Bundesliga, one of the best leagues in the world, Bobby Wood, and another player who's kind of trying to find his way in a different league, and that's Rubio Rubin. So I think
an interesting mix, yeah.
Yeah, we'll see what we get from this game. We'll see who starts. I believe Bobby Wood will probably be the starting striker for this game.
Yeah, I agree. He has performed very well, and he's not necessarily the word veteran, but obviously compared to the
for
the national team.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree with you though.
Yeah, and I think this game will be good for him if he does get on the field, which, like we said, I think he will get on the field because it'll allow him to hopefully showcase that his struggles this year aren't truly his fault. Mm. I think some of his struggles can be attributed to Hamburg's
team
as a whole.
Yeah. They've been through some managers too, right?
Yeah, so they just got a new manager this past weekend. So we'll see what that does for Bobby. But yeah, hopefully he gets game time in this game. Even if he doesn't score, I think getting on the field and making some good runs, looking dangerous in that final third, I think that'll do a lot for his confidence. And I think it'll also do a lot for us U.S. men's national team fans who have been concerned with him all season at Hamburg.
Definitely. And Austin, we were talking about this again off camera a little bit and just touching on some of your points as well, that he kind of broke onto the scene way back when in a few friendlies and scored some great goals, and that really
under
Jurgen there really revived his club career, and he's made some great moves, and just hopefully this although it's just one game, this brief stint, like Austin said, if he plays well and makes some great runs, starts to get that confidence back in himself through the national team, that could be really great just to end the Bundesliga with Hamburg in a solid note and lift them out of that relegation area.
Yeah, hopefully.
That's what we can hope for.
Yeah, and then obviously maybe want to finish with Andrija Novakovich.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Player who we've documented now for the past few episodes, who's really killing it in that second league over in the Netherlands, the Jupiler League, or the Eredivisie. But it's really good to see him on this roster. It's good to see a player who's in fine form finally getting his due call up. So we've talked about him so much now that I feel like every time we talk about him, we're just saying the same thing.
Great things.
But yeah, he's a very physical striker, kind of skinny.
Yeah, what is he, 6'3", 6'4"?
Yeah, I think he's like 6'3". Very, very tall. But we'll see if he can get some game time in this game. Like I touched on earlier, six players will have to miss out. So you got to think one of these strikers will probably not see the field. Mm-hmm. So hopefully Andrija won't be that striker. Maybe Rubio Rubin will be that striker.
Yeah, I mean.
Although we'll see. It depends on who plays well in camp. So if he deserves game time, I feel like the coaches will give him that game time if he deserves it. And if he does deserve it, then that's a good sign. If he doesn't, then maybe we'll take this camp with a grain of salt and see what he can do for the rest of this year. But we're really excited about this game. We'll be watching it. We also want to announce that we'll be doing a special episode. We'll release it either the night of the game or the next day, depending on how our schedule goes. We'll see what it's like, but we'll basically just do like a quick reaction to the game, talk about some of the things that happened in the game,
stay tuned.
Yeah, yeah. So that's all we have for this segment.
And finally, we'll head into our last segment, Quick Kicks.
So you could test Dwayne Miller. It's Altidore over the wall. And that one is in. Josie Altidore from a long way out. The opening goal for the United States.
So first off, Keaton Parks played 80 minutes in his usual midfield role for Benfica B.
And Weston McKennie this weekend unfortunately had to miss Schalke's game due to a muscle injury. However, Schalke won 1-0 over Wolfsburg.
And Kyle Scott for Chelsea's U23s went down 3-1 to Arsenal, but Kyle Scott also got the goal.
And Bobby Wood actually played for the first time in two games, played 25 minutes in Hamburg's 2-1 loss, unfortunately, to Hertha.
And CCV again, another unfortunate situation with a 1-0 loss. He played the full 90, but a 1-0 loss to Bristol City.
And finally, Haji Wright played 22 minutes in Sandhausen's unfortunate 3-2 loss this weekend to Bochum, where they're up 2-0 at halftime. So thanks for watching, guys. Make sure you subscribe to this channel and like this video.
And make sure to check out our awesome social media pages, our Twitter and Instagram pages.
And leave a comment in the comment section. We would love to interact with you guys. And just a reminder, this upcoming week on Tuesday night or even Wednesday, we're going to be posting a video of our reaction to the U.S. Men's National Team game against Paraguay. So look out for that.
And Austin, what is that go-to line? That one day, Austin, what's going to happen?
Hopefully we'll see some of those players that'll do this next Tuesday.
Ooh.
But one day, we will win the World Cup. One day.